wa ta'ala and his names and attributes, etc. So, can you please write something pertaining to it? So he wrote this. Tawheed is of three types, Rububiyyah, Uluhiyyah, and Asma wa Sifat. This book, which Tawheed does it deal with? Asma wa Sifat. And also what else? And? Huh? Not really. That's not Rububiyyah. Allah being the creator, nurturer, he didn't talk about that. Uluhiyyah, ibadah, not really. I get you, I get what you mean, but not really. That's more mannerisms and that stuff. Ubudiyyah would be what is worship of Allah and what is not. What worships are accepted, what is not. That stuff he doesn't talk about. Basically, Tabat Tawheed speaks about uluhiyyah, things that are shirk and things that are not shirk. That's uluhiyyah, right? He doesn't talk about that here. He talks about asma wa sifat and the six pillars of iman, taken out the first one, which is Allah. He speaks about what? Angels. He speaks about books. He speaks about messengers. He speaks about qadr. He speaks about the day of resurrection. So this book, how is it divided? Is asma wa sifat of Allah, his names and attributes, how to understand it, principles, each name, not every single one, but the majority of the names he goes through, what they mean, principles to have the correct understanding of them. Then he speaks about what? The day of resurrection, the belief in angels, is to do with those six pillars and asma wa sifat. Clear or not clear? There's a chapter where he speaks about also what should we believe about the Sahaba, which is also vital. Very good. Really quickly, what does it mean to believe in Allah? Look, and tu'mina billahi wa malaikati. Because look, the Shaykh, he said, amma ba'du fahada i'tiqadu al-firqati al-najiyah al-mansurati ila qiyam al-sa'ah ahli sunnati wal-jama'ah wa huwa, and that is al-imanu billah. Mada yaqtadi al-imanu billah? Mada yaqtadi al-imanu billah? What does believing in Allah necessitate? Yeah. Wujud Allah, Allah exists. His rububiyyah, uluhiyyah, his asma wa sifat. Very good. Al-iman billah yaqtadi arba'ata umur. It necessitates four things. Al-iman bi wujud Allah, that Allah exists. Al-iman bi rububiyyah Allah, Allah's rububiyyah, lordship. Al-iman bi uluhiyyah, his right to worship. والإيمان بأسمائه وصفاته. Make sense or not? Then he said, وملائكته. ماذا يقتضي الإيمان بالملائكة? What does belief in angels necessitate? Aya? You have to believe that they are an unseen creation. Aya? Made from light. They're obedient to Allah, they don't disobey Allah. And they have certain jobs that they've been given that they carry out. Good. أَنَّهُمْ خَلْقٌ مِّنْ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ وَأَنَّهُمْ مَخْلُوقُونَ مِّنْ نُورِ وَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْصُونَ اللَّهِ مَا أَمَرَهُمْ وَيَفْعَلُونَ مَا يُؤْمَرُونَ وَكُلُّهُمْ لَهُمْ وَظِيفَةٌ. They all have jobs. Okay, then the Shaykh said, وَكُتُبِهِ. ماذا يقتضي الإيمان بكتب الله? What does iman in the books of Allah necessitate? Daniela. جيد, perfect. Then he said, ورسله. ماذا يقتضي الإيمان برسل الله? What does to believe in Allah's messengers, what is it necessitate? ماذا يقتضي الإيمان برسله? Aya? نعم. Good? نعم. طيب. نعم. When someone says you have to believe in Allah's messengers, you don't just say that some people called messengers exist. La. is al-i'tiqad al-jazim to 100% belief, annahum bashar, they are men. They are humans. Dhukurun, they are all males. Uhiya ilayhim bishara, wa umiru bitabrihi, they were given a legislation, and they were commanded to give this legislation to their people. وَبَلَّغُ الرِّسَالَةِ وَأَدَّوُ الْأَمَانَةِ, and they've done this job. That's what you need to believe. They completed the job of passing on the message of Islam. The Shaykh then said, وَالْبَعْثِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ. مَاذَا يَقْتَضِ الْإِيمَانُ بِالْبَعْثِ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ. What does belief in the hereafter necessitate? In English, it's fine. That person, once he dies, will be resurrected, will be brought back to life, Allah will question him, and then he'll be rewarded for his bad deeds, if Allah decides, and likewise for his good deeds as well. الاعتقاد الجازم بأن الله يبعث العبادة بعد موتهم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect the people once they die. There's another life. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will return the people's souls into their bodies. They will get up, and then there will be a questioning. Last but not least, ماذا يقتضي الإيمان بالقدر خيره وشره. I want someone to answer this by putting their hand up. What does, when someone says, you have to believe in the Qadr of Allah, what does that necessitate? What does it mean? If someone says, you have to believe in the Qadr of Allah. Hey, someone here? Back. You believe in Qadr, sah? Do you believe in Qadr? Do you believe you came to the masjid because of the Qadr of Allah? Okay, what is that you believe? I want to know. Allah decreed everything. Tayyib, good. Ayah? Adi. Predestination, that's a translation. What do you mean by predestination? I'm a non-Muslim and I want to know the answer. When you people, you Muslims or you Muslimics, when you say predestination, everything was pre-decreed, everything else, what do you mean by that? Tayyib, bismillah. Allah, He knows all. Ilm Allah, Allah knows and knew and will know everything that happens and happened and will happen. One. Then once Allah knew it and He will know and He will forever know, Allah decided to write down everything that will happen. Meaning none of the things that happen in life happen except that Allah wrote it to happen. Good? Good. What we also mean is, the actions that happen on the face of this earth and take place, what we mean by this, the Qadr of Allah, Allah created the actual action. Three. Last but not least. The fourth one is Al-Mashi'ah, He willed it to happen. Meaning, this happening didn't happen except Allah wanted it to happen. Are you guys with me or not? I told you, Qadr has four stages. There's four stages of Qadr that every single Muslim must believe. Otherwise, his belief in the predestiny, pre-decree is not correct. The first one is Al-Ilm. Allah knew it before it even happened. If you say, Allah decreed it, but He never knew it happened until it happened, that's not believing in it. Ilm Allah. The second one is, what's the second one? Al-Kitabah. عِلْمُهُ وَكِتَابَتُهُ. Allah wrote it down, it's written in the Lawh al-Mahfuz before we were created. By the way, there's a whole chapter of Qadr. We're going to, inshallah, dissect very well. The third one is that Allah created this act you're doing. Are you guys with me or not? وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Allah created it. And last but not least, it's al-Mashi'ah. كُلُّ أَفْعَالِ الْعِبَادِ تَحْتَ مَشِيئَةِ اللَّهِ. Every single act that people do is under the will of Allah. Allah wants it and decided for it to happen. It didn't happen except with His will. That was the introduction we've done, and then we also categorized, of course, the Tawheed into three as well, etc., etc. Okay. We're not finished, sir. هذه كان آخر. ميكروفونك اخر ده. Hey, we're going to start from القواعد الأساسية في الإيمان بأسماء الله وصفاته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الإيمان بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله والبعث بعد الموت، والإيمان بالقدر خيره وشره. ومن الإيمان بالله الإيمان بما وصف به نفسه في كتابه وبما وصفه به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من غير تحريف ولا تعطيل ومن غير تكييف ولا تمثيل، بل يؤمنون بأن الله سبحانه وتعالى ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير، فلا ينفون عنه ما وصف به نفسه، ولا يحرفون الكلمة عن مواضعه، ولا يلحدون في أسماء الله تعالى وآياته، ولا يكيفون ولا يمثلون صفاته بصفات خلقه، لأنه سبحانه وتعالى لا سمي له ولا كفو له ولا ند ولا كفو له ولا ند له، ولا يقاس بخلقه سبحانه وتعالى، فإنه سبحانه أعلم بنفسه وبغيره، وأصدق قيلا وأحسن حديثا من خلقه. ثم رسله صادقون مصدقون بخلاف الذين يقولون عليه ما لا يعلمون. ولهذا قال سبحانه وتعالى: سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. فسبح نفسه عما وصفه به المخالفون للرسل، وسلم على المرسلين لسلامة ما قالوه من النقص والعيب. الجمع بين النفي والإثبات في وصفه تعالى، وهو سبحانه قد جمع فيما وصف به نفسه بين النفي والإثبات.
Okay, today inshallah ta'ala we're going to take seven. Remember I told you the first two, three lessons is going to be an introduction where we are going to take principles. Who remembers me saying, what did I say last time? We're going to do what? Who remembers last lesson what I said about we're going to take certain things in the next few lessons that will help us dissect the rest of the points? What did I say? We're just going to learn principles that will aid the person to understand Allah's names and attributes better. His principles best. Are you there or not? Write these down. Today I'm going to give you seven. Seven principles that you need to know like the back of your hand. Seven principles that you need to know like the back of your hand. Number one, al-iman بصفات الواردة. الإيمان الإيمان بصفات الواردة في القرآن والسنة الصحيحة. الإيمان بالصفات الواردة في القرآن والسنة الصحيحة. I've just sent it to the Telegram channel if you want to take a look at the seven points. But you need to have these, as I said, like the back of your hand. The second one is الاعتماد على الوحي. الاعتماد على الوحي. That's enough. الاعتماد على الوحي. الاعتماد على الوحي. Number three is the most vital one. It is التحرز. التحرز من التحرز. As I said, I'll have it written down next time on the board. من محاذير أربعة. من محاذير أربعة. التحرز من محاذير أربعة. Number four. لا يلحدون في أسماء الله. لا يلحدون في أسماء الله. لا يلحدون في أسماء الله. Number five. لا يعملون بالقياس. لا يعملون بالقياس. I'll explain each one inshallah ta'ala, so don't worry. لا يعملون بالقياس. الشمول والتمثيل. لا يعملون بالقياس الشمول والتمثيل. لا يعملون بالقياس الشمول والتمثيل. The next one is يؤمنون أهل السنة أن موجبات الخبر أو أن موجبات قبول الخبر. يؤمنون أهل السنة والجماعة أن موجبات قبول الخبر متوفرة في كلام الله. متوفرة في كلام الله. Last but not least, الجمع بين النفي والإثبات. الجمع بين النفي والإثبات. We're going to go through each one of them step by step and understand each one of them, inshallah ta'ala. And then we'll see how the Shaykh, he just said all of that I just said to you now in the beginning part that our brother read for us. Are you there? So the first one we said was, الإيمان بصفات الواردة في القرآن والسنة الصحيحة. What's this list of seven things I just mentioned, by the way? They are principles pertaining to what? Not to know Allah. They are principles that one needs to have understood and memorized for them to not get confused in any topic pertaining to the names and attributes of Allah. They are principles to make you understand the names and attributes of Allah. Shall I give you an example? Let's look at the first one. The first one says, الإيمان بصفات الواردة في القرآن والسنة. Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, the way they are specific and exclusive in this chapter of Bab al-Sifat, Asma' al-Sifat, is the first point. They look into the Qur'an and the Sunnah, which is Sahiha. Anytime they want to see a name of Allah, or they want to see a attribute of Allah, where do they directly take the source from? What source do they take it directly from? Al-Qur'an, the Sunnah is Sahiha. Do they take names and attributes of Allah directly and only from Sahaba? No. Even Sahaba, we reject a name and attribute they come with. Why is that is the question. Look, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, first of all, what are the names and attributes of Allah? They are things which characterize him, right? They give him the characteristics. How can you personally know what characteristics someone has, realistically? How can you know right now what Abdullah has like? By spending time with him, by seeing him. If you want to describe me, you need to see me, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ghaib. He's in the unseen. He's in the unseen. For someone to describe him, it must and must come through Allah describing himself or his messenger describing him. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gives that message to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if a sahabi comes and says, there's a name of Allah which is this, this, this. What's the correct way Ahlus-Sunnah wal Jama'ah are going to go through verifying that? It's the first point. الإيمان بالصفات الواردة في القرآن والسنة الصحيحة. Clear or not clear? Even Sahaba have been rejected in this matter. No Sahabi can come and say, one of Allah's name is this. La, it's not going to be accepted. Show me where is it in the Quran and Ahadith. Why did we say As-Sahiha, the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? Because there's some which aren't necessarily authentic. You know, there's some Ahadith that are munkar. You learn inshallah Mustalah Hadith. There are also ones that maybe one Sahabi narrated it, or there's some ikhtilaf on the authenticity of it. In matters pertaining to fiqh, there's certain ahadith which you can take if they have, for example, a shahid. Let's say there's a hadith which doesn't have many narrators. Okay? And the wording that this hadith came in, only one companion said it like this. And this companion might be a bit unknown. No one really knows him that well. This hadith is going to be considered as weak by default. There's a type of weak it's going to be. But weak ahadith can be made stronger by other ahadith which don't have the same wording, but they have similar meaning. Are you with me or not? It's like, I'll give an example. Right now, if I say to you, today I went to the class. Let me reword it. Let's say you have a brother. And your brother's a naughty boy, never goes classes, you know, he's very rude, he just plays game all day. You know him to be a guy, he's not going classes or anything like that. In the topic of him telling you that he went to classes, is he considered reliable or not? No. Imagine if he said, today I went to tafsir class, you know? What if he said that to you? Or let's say, may Allah protect us all from it and our families, he's involved in drugs and he drinks alcohol and he's completely off the deen. If he comes to you and says, MashaAllah, today I was learning Aqidah Wasatiyah. What are you going to say to him? Nah, you are, man, stop lying. Are you with me or not? Is there a possibility that his news is correct though? Of course. If he has something called a shahid, meaning another person, so his news alone, we're going to say, nope, is mardud, we reject it. If another person who's slightly more reliable than him, who goes classes, MashaAllah, he says, nah, akhi, he went today, man, I saw him. What are we going to say now? We pushed it up. In matters pertaining to fiqh, you know, stuff like where we put our hands, or if we do this, do we move our finger or not? Matters pertaining to fiqh, that kind of situation is met, and you've taken this hadith up, even though it's in weak narration, you can act upon that act. You guys with me or not? You can act upon in fiqh, matters pertaining to fiqh, these kind of a hadith, you can use it as an evidence. When it comes to aqidah, it is not accepted. It's not accepted. This is what you need to realize. This is the first principle. Anyone who ever says to you, Akhi, mashallah, one of Allah's names is this. What's the first qa'idah? Al-Quran wa sunnah sahiha am la? First question. Says to you, Ma Akhi, Qatada ibn Bi'amati Sadusi said it. I heard Abdullah ibn Abbas said it in this. Mardud. We don't accept it. Clear or not clear? The second principle is, We're going to come on to that in a whole different chapter, inshallah. We're going to come on to it in a whole different chapter. The second one is al-i'timadu 'ala al-wahyi fi bab al-asma' wa-s-sifat. When we look at the chapter of asma' wa-s-sifat, generally, the Quran is number one. The Quran is number one. Of course, there's Quran, there's Sunnah, and everything else, but the Quran takes precedence because it's pure, it's mahab, it's 100% wahyi. So the first and second are pretty much the same, so we can make them six for today, inshaAllah ta'ala. First and second one are very similar. What's another problem though, if someone comes to you without using a hadith or an ayah, if he says to you, this is one of Allah's names. Someone comes to you and says, this is one of Allah's names, and he can't give you a hadith or an ayah, what does that mean? First, what's the reason why? If someone says to you, Akhi, but why can't I use the Sahaba? What's the, I just explained it to you now. Because Allah is knowledge of the unseen. If you haven't seen Allah, how can you describe Him to me? Are you with me or not? If I haven't seen Allah, how can I describe Him? Who is befitting to describe Allah the most? Huh? Allah. That's why we're saying we are only going to stick to Quran and Sunnah. Quran because Allah is describing Himself. And Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam because Allah is the unseen, Allah is informing Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam of who He is. Does that make sense or not? Did Allah inform Sahaba who He is? No, He didn't. He only did through the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The second one, where's the third one? So we're going to skip the second inshaAllah. Is at-taharruz min mahadirin arba'ah. At-taharruz, to abstain completely. At-taharruz. At-taharruz doesn't just mean, you know, abstain to be honest. At-taharruz means, you know, if you were to see a fire, like how much would you protect yourself from it? Would you even go anywhere near it? Nah. Don't even go near from four mahadirin arba, four things that are warned against, four dangerous matters. You stay completely away from them. We're going to look at these four. I'm going to mention them, then I'm going to give you the definitions of them, inshaAllah ta'ala. The first one is tahrif. Tahrif. The first one is tahrif. The first one is tahrif. The second one is ta'atil. Ta'atil. Second one is ta'atil. The third one is takyif. The third one is takyif. Abdurrahman, what have you got written down? Tahrif, good. The last one is, last but not least, tamthil. Tamthil. If you are ever asked, by the way guys, there's going to be an exam at the end of this, inshallah. There's going to be speaking exams that I want to do before every single lesson. At the end, we're going to give you an exam. If someone says to you, what are the four mahadir al-arba'a in the chapter of Asma al-Sifat? What are you going to say? Tahrif? Ta'atil, tamthil, and takif. What do they mean? When we look at tahrif, it means in the Arabic language, at-taghyir wa tabdil. It means to change. Tahrif means to change something around. Harrafa, yuharrifu tahrifan. Allah says in the Quran when you speak about Jews, yuharrifuna al-kalima. And mawadi'ihi. What do? Tabdeel and taghyeer, which means to change. They change the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from one place to another. That's what they've done, sah? Yuharrifuna al-kalima and mawadi'ihi. So tahrif means to change something around. What does it mean in this topic of aqeedah? Let's practicalize it. We have asma' wa sifat of Allah, yes? Allah said in the Quran that He has a hand. He has a hand. Are we going to change what Allah said, or are we going to keep it the way it is? He said a hand, right? Keep it as hand. The way this is going to help you is, there's a group that said, when Allah said, I created Adam with my hand, automatically, what did they go against? They said, no. What it means is that He created Adam alayhi salam with His mercy. He created him with His power. Are you with me or not? By default, what have they done? The third principle they broke, which was what? Stay away from four things, completely stay away from them. They broke the first one, which was tahrif. They changed, what did they change? Yad to rahmah. We say leave it as it is. Is that clear or not clear? The second one is at-ta'atil. Ta'atil. Ta'atil means al-khulul, khulul, which basically is to destroy or to make something empty. To make something empty, you take it out.
What did the people that said Allah doesn't have a hand, because what it means is power, what did they do? Did they completely take the characteristic away? No. What did they do? They don't tahrif, meaning change. These guys that say ta'wil, ta'atil, they completely cancel it out. No, we don't accept this one. Are you there? Now, do you know what they've done, these people? They used their logic. They basically said, there are certain, pay attention to this, they said there are certain characteristics that Allah mentioned in the Quran, and they necessitate by default. It's not our choice. We're not trying to do it. But they say, the moment that we hear this kind of word, it necessitates that we must come with resemblance. Therefore, if we make resemblance of a characteristic of Allah, which we're not trying to do, but this characteristic just by default necessitates resemblance, we're going to take that out completely. Shall I give an example? Example. Let's stick to the same example of yad, or even a shin. Allah said in the Quran, يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِعُونَ. Allah is going to unveil His shin on the day of resurrection. The people that will do ta'atil, what would they say? If they're going to do ta'atil of this, they're saying to themselves,